Graphic Audio presents Superpowers, Year 3, Part 2, by Drew Hayes. Narrated by Jonathan Lee Taylor and performed by a full cast.
Alice stood before her dorm mates in the Melbrook common room, running down the guest list, jotted on the yellow legal pad in her hand.
Okay, so far confirmed we have Thomas, Violet, Jill, Will, Camille, Adam, Alex, Angela, and Shane, while Sasha, Brittany, and Amber are all maybes.
Correct.
Mary sat next to Chad, grateful that he and his perfect memory had been recruited into assisting with Alice's party preparations. Mary was tired of having that responsibility dumped on her.
So, counting all of us from Melbrook and the three mystery guests Mary refuses to talk about...
Mary suddenly found the costume catalog in her lap to be very interesting.
I think that brings us to a confirmed 17, possibly 20.
I admit, my experience with social outings is greatly lacking compared to most students our age. However, that strikes me as a difficult number of people to manage in a bar setting.
He's right. We've only got a few days left, and even if we found a place that took reservations, we'd never get in.
Alice thrust an accusatory index finger at Mary.
You're right that we've only got a few days, which is why you're supposed to be picking a damn costume. I told you, no getting off the couch until you've selected something. I've gotten everyone else, even Chad and Vince, to get their stuff. You will not be the only person uncostumed on Halloween.
If we can even find a place.
I will book us a place. We are going to meet Halloween head on this year, and that means being together. I don't care if I have to book 3 VIP sections to do it. We will have a place to go.
Mary let the last of her resistance fade away. Of all of them, Alice had taken Nick's loss most to heart. The chance to build a memory of everyone together clearly meant a lot to her.
Okay, what did Chad and Vince pick? Herschel won't tell me about Roy's costume, so if there's a theme, I'd like a heads up.
I'm going to be a robot, apparently. I'm not certain what Vince is. He should be off work in a few hours, though. You can ask him then.
Wait, hang on. A robot?
I think so. I asked Angela for advice, and she said she had the perfect costume for me. When I probed deeper, all she would say is that it was shiny and metallic. So the logical assumption is a robot.
Alice resisted the urge to point out that Angela's thought processes were normally far from logical.
Anyway, there is no theme, so pick whatever you think looks good.
I wish I could just wear my work outfit. It fits me well and is already done. Stupid rules about not wearing our uniforms in social settings.
It's also considered bad form to wear hero costumes when in the HCP. Although I've never understood why.
Originally, I heard it was to keep ourselves as dissociated from heroes as possible. But as time goes on, I've begun to think it's just one of those fashion rules that became law. Like not wearing white after Labor Day. Now, back to the catalog. Come on, you must have a few standouts.
Well, the Victorian outfits are gorgeous, but the idea of moving around in something like that all night seems like a massive pain. Then there's the skimpy stuff I don't know how anyone would have the courage to wear out in public. Maybe I'll just use my princess costume from last year again.
Nope, no repeats. That's counter to the spirit of Halloween.
Alice reached over and plucked the catalog from Mary's hands.
Look, are you willing to just trust me?
To do what?
Pick out your costume for you. I've got your measurements. I can place the order. Come on. Chad let someone else pick out his costume.
Chad is dating the person he trusted with that responsibility.
Would you rather I let Herschel choose? I bet he's got a few outfits he would love to see you in.
Mary's cheeks grew momentarily red. And she gave her head a firm shake.
No, no, definitely no. Fine, you can pick. But I reserve the right to veto what you pick if it makes me uncomfortable.
Only if you try it on before rejecting it.
Privately. Just you and me. No witnesses, no pictures.
Deal.
Deal.
Mary and Alice had forgotten that Chad was in the room until he spoke up.
It occurs to me, after observing these negotiations, that perhaps I should have put some rules into place with Angela, rather than giving her free rein over my costume selection.
I'm sure it will be fine. How bad can a robot costume be?
The bar was busy for a late October weekday, but not so packed that empty seats were unavailable. Case in point, one table for 4 was occupied by only one woman, She sipped slowly on a glass of white wine as she flipped idly through the pages in her book. Anyone who was in the bar looking for companionship would have noticed her delicate yet sharp features, short blonde hair, and toned body. But despite her obvious beauty, no one approached. Her demeanor indicated clearly that any overtures would be rejected. One man, after walking into the bar with another, better-dressed man at his side, disregarded those signals and bounded over to her table.
What?
She dropped her book and whipped around, ready to inflict some damage.
Miss me?
Sean? You're really out? You didn't...
No, he didn't. He's working with me these days.
At Blaine's appearance, Sean released the woman.
It's been too long, Clarissa.
That it has.
Clarissa stepped back and regarded the two men.
I have to say, I was surprised when you contacted me. Our class isn't great about keeping in touch.
She made no mention of how hard she'd worked to stay off the grid. Blaine already knew. Clarissa pulled out her chair, and Sean and Blaine joined her at the table.
Well, at least in my case, I've got an excuse for not calling.
Yeah, I guess so. Speaking of which, what's the deal with this? You couldn't tell me Sean was out or that he was coming along?
I could have, but Sean thought it would be more fun to surprise you in person.
And how right I was.
Okay, I'll give you that. But, I mean, how did you get out this early?
Work release. Did you hear about what happened with Blaine's staff 2 years ago?
Only a few rumors here and there. I'm not very connected since I retired.
Let's leave the details for a more private discussion. Suffice it to say, I needed to do some rapid restaffing, and despite his later career choices, Sean definitely has a considerable resume.
Clarissa nodded her understanding. Being from the class of legends was pretty much an open door to any super or hero-related job. It was one of the reasons she'd originally made herself as absent as possible from the hero world.
So, was this why you wanted to meet? Because I have to tell you, this is a surprise worth braving the bar scene for.
Partially, yes. However, I have to admit something up front. I also came here for selfish reasons.
You're a dean now. I'd be a fool if I showed up expecting anything less.
Glad you understand the situation. You see, I'm setting up the junior year guest speakers, and one of the ones I had lined up dropped out due to a conflict. With short notice, it would be hard to get someone as good, so I was thinking that perhaps an old friend could fill in?
Blaine, I don't know. I left that world a long time ago. I'm not sure what I'd have to talk to them about.
That's why he wants you. This is the speaker who talks about what life is like after. To show them that you do go on living once the career is done. You seem to be doing great, and with your background, it would mean a lot to some of the kids to hear from you.
I suppose so. Fine, I'll help out, but only if you get the first three rounds.
A more than fair bargain. There is also one thing I should give you a warning about. I seriously doubt it will come up in any way, but I would be remiss as a friend and colleague if I didn't let you know.
With a preamble that long, this must be a bad one. Maybe I should have negotiated my price harder.
We can reopen it if needed, but I don't think this is particularly bad. Just something you should know. Retired or not, I have no doubt you saw the news last year about Phil.
Yeah, it was pretty hard to miss.
I won't linger on the subject. I know how close you and he were. I just feel that you should know that in his time away, Phil adopted and raised a young boy off the streets. That boy is currently in the class you'll be speaking to. Again, I see almost no way this could come up. However, it seemed wrong to let you come without telling you.
How could Phil have... Never mind. Knowing him, he'd have found a way.
Clarissa took a long, steady drink from her glass of wine.
Well, that is a hell of a curveball to throw someone. Phil had a son, sort of.
Indeed.
What's he like?
He's a good kid. Tough, strong, kind of dopey, and ridiculously loyal.
In other words, a lot like Phil. Okay, then. I'll still do it. I'm not sure if I'll want to talk to him, or even know which one he is, but I'll come speak to the class. However, I'm amending our agreement. The rounds you buy have to be top shelf. Agreed?
For you, Clarissa, I will happily strike that bargain.
I'm not coming out.
The residents of Melbrook and their friends all stared at the boys' lounge door, except for Chad. He was behind said door.
I was misled on my costume, and I feel it is inappropriate to walk around in it.
Oh, don't be such a spoil sport.
Angela's costume was a mystery, concealed as it was by a long blue robe. Her blonde hair was teased up in a messy bundle.
It can't be that bad.
Alice was dressed in a blue and white dress with a simple black hairband running across her head. Sewn to her left shoulder was a purple-striped, stuffed cat with a wide grin. Dressing up as another Alice appealed to Alice's sense of humor.
I assure you, it can be that bad.
Vince, Roy, you two want to pop open the door and drag him out?
You say that like he won't put up much of a fight. Not that I object, but I'd hate to get blood on my outfit.
Roy's outfit consisted of a pair of baggy red satin shorts that ran down to his knees, soft-soled shoes, a red silk robe across his shoulders, and a pair of boxing gloves tied together and hung around his neck. It was as much of a compromise as Herschel had been able to strike with his brother, in that, at least this way, Roy's shirtlessness seemed to be part of a genuine costume effort, and when Herschel took over, he could close the robe.
Don't feel silly, Chad. I mean, you should see me.
Vince was wearing a red, yellow, and orange knit hat with a pom-pom on top. The ear flaps were very effective at concealing his silver hair.
I let Alex coordinate our costumes, and I don't even know who I am.
For the love of... How many times do I have to tell you this? You're Jane, I'm Mal, and Will is Wash.
Alex wore a chocolate-colored coat hanging to his calves, high boots, and a genuine replica pistol strapped to his side.
I don't know what that means.
Just tell people you're a brown coat.
Will wore a brown shirt and loose khakis. Over the brown shirt was a flowered Hawaiian shirt.
No, Jane wasn't... Oh, screw it. Sure, why not?
Chad, I took a risk letting Alice choose my costume, and while it's a little more than I'd have picked out, it still looks nice.
Mary was clad in tan slacks that hugged her legs, a period blouse dipping just a bit below the neck, and a large, voluptuous red cloak. Even without the picnic basket, she was clearly meant to be a modest, yet sexy Red Riding Hood.
More is not my concern.
Well, you need to get over your concerns soon. We're meeting Thomas and Camille's bunch in half an hour, and if I'm not there, they won't let them into the area I reserved. How about we be fair and leave it to a group vote? Come out and let the room decide if Angela has asked you to wear a bad costume. If they say yes, I'm sure we have an old spare we can lend you. If not, you deal with it, and we get moving. Okay?
Wow. What?
The wolf whistle came from Angela.
Angela, that is highly inappropriate.
Mary did her best to look Chad directly in the eyes and nowhere else.
Chad, I thought you were going to be a robot.
A robot? Where did you get that idea?
You said metallic, shiny, and perfect for me. I made assumptions.
I kept my word, didn't I? I mean, you're a blonde man in superhumanly good shape. Rocky seemed like a good fit.
I've seen Rocky around 10 times, and at no point does he wear a shiny gold Speedo.
Wrong, Rocky. Check Herschel's memories. Angela is talking about Rocky from the Rocky Horror Picture Show, which, if I were to take a stab in the dark, would mean she's dressed as Janet.
Give nerd boy a prize.
Oh, damn.
Under the robe, Angela was wearing a white bra and a half slip that ended in a torn, misshapen line well above her knees.
See, Chad? I got us a couple's costume. Aren't I just the sweetest?
I notice that you are still wearing a considerable amount more than I am.
Oh? Did you want me to even that out?
Angela started to reach around her back to the catch on her brassiere.
No, no, you do not need to expose yourself.
So, you'll wear the costume without complaining?
I never said that.
Then you're going to change? After I went to all the trouble of picking these out just for us so anyone who looked would know we're together, you're just going to wear some other costume and leave me looking silly?
No, I will not. Let's go to the party. As is.
Chad, you're just too much fun. Once we're in the car, you can put on your real shorts. You'll still be Rocky, but this pair will leave a lot more to the imagination.
I'm confused.
I just wanted to see if you'd actually wear that for me.
Angela moved in close and gave him a small, lingering kiss on the cheek.
Now that I know, there's no way I'm letting you out of the house in those things. I'd be batting other women away all night, and that's just not my idea of how to have a good time.
Dang, that has got to be, mothers excluded, the most downright terrifying woman I have ever met.
Yes, she is.
Despite the seriousness of his words, Chad put his arm around Angela.
Hmm.
The club Alice had chosen, Dashabout, was higher in scale than many of the dives they'd visited, or in a few cases, were working at. It was frequented not just by lowly college students out to score cheap drinks and get laid, but also by an older, more sophisticated crowd of graduates who were looking to score cheap drinks and get laid. The fake IDs Nick had provided the previous year came in handy, but few in the group needed to use them, since the majority of them had crossed that mythical threshold into the age of 21. As the Melbrook group entered, they were approached by a cheerful young brunette woman dressed as a fairy princess. After a quick chat with Alice and a few last-minute forms being signed, she ushered them through the club to their area. It was an expansive space, done up in steel and mirrors. Already, the bar area swelled with patrons clamoring to be served, so they could establish a fresh buzz before the remainder of the intoxication from their pre-gaming wore off. The dance floor was less cluttered. Despite the subtle thump of bass and the swirl of multicolored lights enticing people to come gyrate, most were either drowning the liquid courage that dancing would require, or didn't want to sweat through their costumes just yet. The fairy princess showed them up a small section of stairs to an elevated platform. On it were several couches, some plush chairs, and tables centrally located near every seat. The elevation provided them a view of the still sparse dance floor, as well as a good line of sight on the door. Alice, the party planner, had known they'd have lots of people filtering in and wanted to be able to spot them upon entrance. She made her way to the center of the platform, drawing their attention before they could even sit down.
All right, everyone, here's the deal. There will be a pair of servers making rounds through the VIP sections, so if you don't want to deal with a bar, you don't have to. That said, they're going to be busy tonight, meaning you may want to open a tab at the bar and start doing some charming and tipping if you're a heavy drinker.
Roy grinned and saluted.
Warning appreciated.
No problem. Now, Bree, that's the fairy princess. We'll show the rest of our friends up here. Again, she's going to be pretty swamped since it's Halloween, and they may not even know to ask her where we are. That means make an effort to keep an eye out. We don't want anyone to feel ditched. Alex, I'm counting on you to catch the stragglers everyone else misses.
Can do. At least until after the first few rounds. Then things get a bit muggy.
Then please pace yourself.
Alice paused, mentally ticking off points as she counted on her fingers.
Okay, I think that's everything you need to know. Obviously, go forth and have fun, and don't worry about leaving your purses or coats unattended. No one who isn't vetted by Bree or escorted by us is getting up here, so valuables are safe. Part of why I picked this place was their great security.
It struck Angela that Alice was going a bit overboard on setting up a safe perimeter. She noticed everyone else going along with it, so she chose not to broach the subject. Chad had told her this group was chaotic. Maybe they'd had bad experiences with clubbing.
That's everything. So, you're all dismissed. And let's have ourselves a happy Halloween for a change.
I'll drink to that.
I think with all you've done, Alice, there's no way we can. Really, thank you. This must have been a lot of work.
More than I expected, but well worth every bit. We're long overdue for a nice, fun, and most importantly, peaceful evening.
It is too a costume.
Eliza planted her fists on her hips and stuck out her tongue.
It's a $3 cat mask.
Much of Nick's freshman year gunslinger costume had been appropriated to create Nicholas's outfit. Colors had been changed, cuts retailored, and, most importantly, a black mask covered the upper half of his face, creating the image of a passable, if not terribly authentic, Lone Ranger.
All you said was that we had to wear masks. Which Jerome didn't even do.
Jerome sat on Nicholas's couch, reading a small book while waiting for the bickering to blow over. It was true that he hadn't worn a mask, but he had certainly rendered himself unrecognizable. His skin was the gray-green hue of dead flesh, and the puckered scars that ran all the way from his face to his neck bolts were sickeningly realistic.
I said we had to be able to hide our faces. If things don't go well and Mary gives us the boot, at least you two will still be unknowns to the group.
So why are you hiding your face?
They'll know you regardless.
Because it seems more prudent to tell them of my return in a controlled manner rather than having them go ballistic when they spot me walking through the door. Now, this is a high-end club, so people there will have taken their outfits seriously. You need to blend in, and that means showing up in something more elaborate than a cap mask, jeans, and a t-shirt.
Eliza looked to Jerome for support. He calmly laid his book on the coffee table.
I have to agree with Nicholas on this one.
Fine. What if I change to black jeans and a slinky black top? Then I'm a sexy black cat. I don't think anyone will say boo to that outfit.
Eliza smirked at her own Halloween humor, a gesture that annoyed Nicholas even more.
That will have to do, but hurry up. I detest arriving after the optimum hour.
Yeah, yeah. You and your showmanship.
Now you've done it.
What?
You pissed her off. Now she'll dawdle just to mess with you.
Great.
Within an hour of the Melbrook group's arrival, most of their friends had shown up and been led to the seating area. Jill, Sasha, and Selena hadn't hung around for long, staying only long enough to drop off purses, say some hellos, and then head out into the thick of the party. Mary was glad to see that Selena and Alex managed to chat cordially for a bit before the other two dragged her away. Time had begun healing the wounds inflicted by their breakup. Camille had come with Thomas and Violet, who were dressed as a fighter pilot and a sexy ladybug, respectively. Camille's short hair was gelled and spiked. She wore a grungy outfit that was illuminated at various points by neon tubes sewn into the fabric. A pair of goggles rested on her forehead, thick boots added a few inches to her height, and a wide variety of bracelets jangled on her wrists. She'd gotten Will's help for the effects, but the construction had been all her. It transformed the small healer into a tough cyberpunk, a costume Alex gave her endless compliments on. As the rest filtered in, they followed a similar pattern. There would be greetings, Alice would give them the lowdown, and they'd thank her for setting things up. Then, most of them would ogle Chad and Angela's Rocky and Janet costumes with a mixture of shock and amusement, depending on their familiarity with the Rocky Horror Picture Show. Then, some would go to mingle at the bar, others to the dance floor. But most settled into the relatively tranquil space on the platform. It was while sitting peacefully that Camille saw Alex jerk up from his seat like he'd sat on a needle. His eyes darted about furiously, an expression of confusion, then concern flashing across his face. Before anyone noticed, Mary was there at his side. The two said nothing as they engaged in telepathic conversation, but Alex's expression gradually transitioned from confusion to anger. Mary kept her usual calm facade with only an occasional twitch of nervousness. Finally, Alex gave a small, begrudging nod and then walked away to sit with Vince and Will. Mary surprised Camille by walking over and plopping down on the sofa next to her.
I know you're wondering what that was all about.
A little bit, yeah. Why was Alex in such a tizzy?
Because I'm an idiot.
Mary leaned her head back, resting it against the black leather seat.
I forgot how good Alex was at recognizing people. I'm trying to do something a little risky tonight, something I wanted to control every aspect of. Alex has graciously agreed to go along with it for now. Hopefully it'll all work out.
I have absolutely no idea what you're talking about.
Camille patted Mary on the leg anyway.
I know you don't. Just needed a vent. You already noticed our talk, so I had to give you an explanation anyway.
It must be hard not having Herschel around when you really need someone.
Even if he were here, I couldn't talk to him yet. But yes, it is hard.
Mary pulled her head up, readjusting her cloak, so it was almost, but not quite, covering her face.
And there is still a lot of night ahead, so I'm just crossing my fingers that Alex is the worst fire I have to put out.
It seems a bit daring to try. Whatever you're doing on Halloween, given your group's track record and all.
You think so? The way I see it, we're long overdue for a bit of good luck on Halloween. This is just me trying to cash in on it.
Mary stood up from the couch.
Maybe you should do the same. You're looking very eye-catching tonight, and I'm keenly aware that a few people have noticed.
Trust me, I know. Alex wouldn't stop fawning.
I wasn't talking about Alex, but you're close. In fact, I'd say you're at the right table, if you catch my meaning.
As she walked away, she passed by Alex, and the two exchanged a furtive glance. Sitting next to him were Will and Vince. As Camille's eyes continued to follow Mary's path, they caught sight of another stare. Vince's bright blue eyes darted away the moment he realized he'd been caught, and Camille blushed. She remembered Mary's words.
We are long overdue for a bit of good luck on Halloween. Maybe I will try to cash in on it.
Nicholas had barely made it 5 minutes past the door when a short figure in a bright red hood sidled up to him. The amber eyes studied him carefully, then turned their scrutinizing gaze on his two companions.
A pleasure to make your acquaintance. My name is Mary, an old friend of Nicholas's, and you are?
Jerome didn't understand why this telepath was pretending not to know who they were, but Nicholas had told them to play nice.
Hi, I'm Jerome.
I'm Eliza.
Eliza took a step forward, perhaps hoping to intimidate Mary with her height. It didn't work.
So glad you all could make it. I'd love to chat and get to know you better later, but I'd like to speak with Nicholas first. Why don't you grab some drinks?
With a small nod from Nicholas, the others took their cue and headed to the bar. Nicholas and Mary shuffled to a spot against the wall between a pair of unoccupied tables, out of sight.
Well, any chance you were followed?
Not that I can tell. Nathaniel is good, but with my full attention, he shouldn't be able to sneak up on me again. But I've learned to take nothing for granted. I would appreciate it if you kept a mental ear open for him.
Way ahead of you. But if he tries anything here, he'll be in for one hell of a surprise. Half of our junior class is in attendance, and plenty of them can do serious damage even without using abilities.
I highly doubt Nathaniel will make a move tonight. He's the sort to lie in wait and lick his wounds after a defeat. Besides, a place this size presents too many uncontrollable factors. It's a poor environment for an ambush.
Let's hope he sees it that way, too. I'd like to have one Halloween that doesn't end in violence.
Mary shifted her position slightly, running her hands along the edge of her cloak.
So, are you ready to meet some old friends?
Don't you mean to go to my audition? Have no fear. I will make them all feel quite at ease with my presence here. How are we going to do this?
I'm going to go up to our section. Once there, I'm going to tell them about you being here and that your memories are still fogged. At that point, anyone who wants to leave the section and meet you will come with me. Those who don't feel like reconnecting with an ex-program member will stay put, and you'll respect that. If everyone comes, then you and your people can join us in our section. If not, you and yours hang out in the main part of the club. I'll listen to everyone's thoughts as the night goes on. If I think you can be among us without causing serious problems, then the next steps will be yours.
What about Jerome and Eliza?
They stay with you. If they're part of your world, then the people reconnecting with you need to know that. All cards on the table.
Funny. As I recall, you were never much of a card player.
Nicholas, you don't recall anything. You just read that in a file.
With that, Mary walked away, red cloak bobbing amidst the sea of bodies as she made her way back to her friends. Nicholas watched her go.
Well, I wouldn't say I don't recall anything.
The memory of their fight in his mind, when she'd discovered his deepest secret in that subliminal church funeral, was crisp as the pain of a fresh wound. He knew Mary was much more than her amiable facade might indicate. When motivated, she was resourceful and unstoppable. That, above all else, was why he was playing along with her game.
Hey, Vince, do you want to dance?
Vince glanced up from his discussion to find Camille standing beside him, hands on hips, as she awaited an answer. It was bluster to cover up for her nervousness, but it only served to make her more beautiful.
Are you sure you want me? I'm not exactly the picture of grace.
And I'm hell in heels. I just feel like moving around a bit and checking out all the other costumes. Plus, I'm trying to work on getting outside my comfort zone, which dancing definitely is. Come help a friend out?
All right. But if I accidentally break one of your toes, don't say I didn't warn you.
As Vince rose from his chair, Alex glanced around the room.
Maybe it's time we all started thinking about getting some dance partners.
Will nudged Alex with his elbow.
Why not try our luck with someone not in direct competition with us? There seem to be plenty of beautiful women who we don't have to fist fight sometime in the near future. The man makes a good point.
Alex and Will stood up as well.
You two should probably go ahead. Will and I need to formulate a game plan. We can't go out there without having proper wingman duties assigned.
I have no idea what you're talking about, and I'm probably better off that way. Come on, Camille. Let's go try not to wound each other.
You ask for the impossible.
The two headed down the stairs and toward the dance floor. Alex watched them go, following the red and yellow striped hat carefully as it navigated through the growing crowd.
So, what are these duties you need performed?
We'll get to that later. The real reason I had us hang back is because Mary's on her way up, and we don't want to miss what she's going to say.
Shouldn't you have stopped Vince?
No way. That he and Camille are finally doing something as intimate as dancing together is, well, not more important, but more pressing. Mary's announcement will be here when he gets back. For now, let's cross our fingers those two finally make some damn headway.
Mary stepped into the seating area and did a quick scan of those present. Angela and Chad were talking on a couch. Will and Alex were standing near the entrance, clearly waiting for her. She spotted Roy, leaning on the side railing, talking with Alice, Violet, and Thomas as he ogled girls in skimpy costumes. The rest, it seemed, were out getting drinks or dancing.
That's okay for the most part, but maybe I should wait for Vince to come back.
I don't think you'll get a point where everyone is present. This seems like almost everyone who would care. Might be good to strike while the iron's hot.
I suppose you're right.
Mary stepped the rest of the way into the section and moved to the middle of it.
Everyone, could you come in close for a minute? There's something I need to talk to you all about.
Curious glances were exchanged, but people moved to within arm's reach of Mary, who was taking measured breaths to stay calm.
I ran into someone a few minutes ago. Someone we all know, or at least used to know. Nick is here. Nick Campbell. He came back to Lander as a regular student after the expulsion, and he's at this club tonight. I talked to him for a bit, his memories are still wiped and all. I just thought you all should know that he was here. He's a little different, losing 2 years will do that, but he's still the same guy he always was underneath. If anyone wants to meet him, I'm gonna go visit with him some more in a bit.
The group stared at Mary in stunned silence for a moment. Chad's skill at manipulating his own emotions allowed him to be the first to respond.
Mary, you know the danger in what you're doing. Those who leave the program often hold bitterness toward the ones that stay. Outing former friends isn't unheard of.
I know, Chad. That's why I came here to tell you all like this rather than bringing him over. Anyone who wants to take that risk can come with me, but I don't think anyone will look down on someone for being cautious.
Count me in.
Angela, you barely ever spoke to Nick.
So what? Still seems like it might be fun. I'm always up for fun.
Then I suppose I should come as well and see this fun for myself.
I'll go talk with it too. Always figured it was only a matter of time before he pulled something like this. Nick loves stirring shit up too much to go out quietly.
I'll go see him.
Alice didn't like pretending to know less about Nicholas than she did. That was why she'd kept her response so simple. Professor Pendleton had taught her that if everything you said was true, then you weren't lying.
I'll sit this one out.
Thomas looked at the floor, not wanting to see any reaction in his friend's eyes.
While Nick and I were friends, we were not close. I don't begrudge him a new life here at Lander. However, I have too much on my own plate at the moment to add another risk. I'm sorry.
Violet laid a hand on his shoulder.
You have nothing to feel bad about. That's a smart decision. So smart, in fact, that I'm going to do the same thing.
As am I.
Will glanced around at his classmates, then made eye contact with Mary again.
Give Nick my best, but I'm afraid it seems unnecessarily dangerous to interact with him anymore.
Makes sense.
Alex shrugged.
But I'm going to say hi. If his memories are sealed, it isn't that dangerous. And I kind of miss that wild-minded jerk.
That's everyone here, then. Would one of the people stay and tell Vince and Camille about this when they come back from dancing?
Thomas raised his hand slightly.
I'll do it. I believe I can explain it to Vince in the easiest way possible.
I don't doubt that. Okay then, everyone else ready to go say hello to an old friend?
Sure. Let's get this show on the road.
Angela hopped out of her seat, an emotion that might have left her chest exposed if she were wearing a more modern bra with less coverage.
We have to knock out the big reveal before the inevitable bar fight.
Alice's head snapped toward Angela, eyes popping in alarm.
Bar fight?
Yeah. Chad filled me in about you hooligans and your Halloween havoc. 2 throwdowns in 2 years? Seems to me we've got decent odds of a three-peat.
For everyone's sake, I dearly hope you're wrong.
Mary began walking toward the stairs, indicating that the others should follow.
I just don't understand you guys. Fate goes out of its way to give you a battle-rich tradition and you try to avoid it? These kids today, no appreciation for the finer things in life.
If we can get through this night without a punch being thrown, I'll consider it a rousing success.
Now, I wouldn't go that far. I mean, I'm not saying I want a full-out brawl, But it is still a party after all. A little scrapping would liven things up.
Angela turned to Chad and jerked her thumb in Roy's direction.
When I'm not around, follow his lead. I like the instincts on this one.
Chad merely shook his head and continued walking, wondering if perhaps his plan to liven up his life hadn't succeeded a bit more than he'd intended. Vince and Camille's attempt at dancing was unsurprisingly awkward. Their discomfort was amplified by the proximity of other couples who were dancing so close, it was often hard to tell them apart. After two songs, Camille made a motion for Vince to leave the dance floor, and he happily obliged. A short distance away, they found an open two-top table with chairs that were so tall, it took Camille a bit of effort to climb into one.
Already tired?
Not tired, just not having that much fun. Sorry about that. As you know, I try to push myself into new things just to get out of my comfort zone. I shouldn't have dragged you along.
I'm glad you did. It's good for me to shake things up once in a while, too. But I don't think I want to do that kind of dancing.
That was a bit much. I might like to try a different kind, though. The two-stepping at the six-shooter wasn't nearly as bad.
Think they'll play any country?
Camille glanced around at the club's upscale decor.
Guess probably not.
Should we go back to the seating area then?
We could, or we could just sit and see if they play something else.
Camille was grateful that her excessive makeup hid the blush she could feel burning her cheeks.
I like that idea. It'll be nice to sit and chat. I feel like I see less of you and Alex since last year.
Well, we do work together.
Yeah, but our schedules are so different. We rarely get the same shifts. Besides, we both stay busy, so it's not like we get a lot of time to hang out.
How do you like the waiting job, anyway?
It's pretty fun. Compared to our normal schedules, it's low stress. Plus, I get to meet a lot of really nice people. The posing for pictures thing took some getting used to, I'll admit that.
That's only families with children, right?
Mostly. If I had gone to a place like Supper with Supers when I was little, I'm sure I would have wanted to get my picture taken with a superhero, even a fake one.
Camille nodded and gave Vince a small smile. She'd seen the children asking to take their picture with Vince, and it wasn't just because he was a waiter in a cape. Vince treated them with even more patience and kindness than he showed most people, which was saying something. He didn't seem to realize it, but the other waiters were asked to pose far less often than him. Deep down, she suspected they could see what she already knew. Their waiter was an authentic hero. He just didn't have the certification yet. Camille felt a warm glow at the thought.
Although, that doesn't explain the groups of adults that ask me to pose.
Groups of adults?
Yeah, usually during late lunch. Mostly women now that I think about it. They always ask me to flex and stuff. Doesn't happen often. In fact, I was so surprised the first time, I asked Brenda what our policy was on that. She told me the customer is always right, but she was giggling when she said it.
Camille's glow burned down to cinders.
Vince, you don't have to do that. Those women were flirting with you.
Really? No, I don't think so. I think they wanted to feel like those kids do. Like they've really gotten to pose with a hero. They know I'm just a waiter in the same way that people who wear Santa outfits aren't the real Santa. But that doesn't mean you still don't get a bit of that childhood thrill by pretending. Just for a second.
That's a sweet way to look at it. But I think you just raised a point we need to discuss.
What's that?
Was that whole speech your subtle way of telling me that you still go get your picture taken with Santa?
Nicholas gave the approaching group a lopsided grin as they drew near, lifting his glass to them.
Old friends, I take it?
Some are. Some were just standing around and decided to tag along. Everyone likes making new friends, after all.
The group gathered around Nicholas, who was camped at a large table. Eliza and Jerome were a few seats over, both pretending to talk with one another.
I certainly agree with that. For any who don't know, my name is Nicholas Campbell, and it is a pleasure to meet you.
A tall man, rippling with muscle that was displayed thanks to his boxer costume, stepped forward and shook Nicholas's hand.
I'm Roy. Good to see you again. You and I were never that close, but my brother Herschel considers you a good friend.
Is your brother here?
Nicholas feigned, looking around, waiting for someone in the crowd to speak up.
He'll be around in a bit.
Angela surprised everyone, especially Chad, by walking up to Nicholas and enveloping him in a giant hug. She held him there for a few seconds, then pulled slightly away.
Baby, oh my sweet man, do you remember me?
No, I don't.
You don't? Even after everything we shared, everything we did, everything I let you do, you've really forgotten me that quickly? You promised you'd always remember.
Some of the observers stared in confusion. Some looked at the floor to hide their grins. Alice just glared. Chad stepped over and set a hand on Nicholas's shoulder.
This is Angela, and I'm Chad. I feel I should tell you that she is, I think the term is messing with you.
Way to kill the bit.
Angela released Nicholas from her arms.
Yeah, we never really met or talked, aside from the occasional chit-chat. Too bad, though. He seems like a nice kid.
With that, she tucked her arm around Chad and stepped out of the way. Captain Maul stepped forward.
I'm Alex. We were pretty good friends.
He wandered off without saying any more than that. Now that he was listening to Nicholas's mind, he knew the lack of knowledge was a sham. Alex wasn't going to blow it open, at least not yet. But he didn't feel particularly obliged to play along either.
And you know me.
Mary and Alice both stepped forward.
This is Alice, my dorm mate and best friend.
Your name is Alice. And you came dressed as Alice.
Your name is Nicholas, and you came dressed as a gay cowboy prostitute. Oh, right, you don't remember, but making fun of each other was kind of our thing.
I cannot imagine I ever brought myself to insult such a lovely woman.
Behind his back, Eliza stuck her finger in her mouth and mimed vomiting.
I'm guessing these are your friends, and I have to say, I already like the girl.
Right. These are some old acquaintances, Jerome and Eliza. They are also pursuing a higher education at Lander.
Nicholas deftly kept the annoyance he felt at being mocked from two sides off his face. Jerome stepped out of his chair first.
Nice to meet you all. Any friend of Nicholas is a friend of ours.
What do you mean, ours? I'll form my own opinions, thank you very much.
Eliza paused to regard the HCP students.
But I guess this lot does seem pretty decent. Way better than your usual crowd, Nicholas. I'm Eliza, by the way.
Angela grinned delightedly.
Hey, she's spunky. Can we keep her?
If it were in my power, I would happily hand her off to you, free of charge.
Eliza elbowed Nicholas lightly in the ribs. He did not react.
Now then, how about we all sit down and catch up a bit? I understand there are topics which cannot be covered, but I'd still love to know more about your lives.
You guys have fun. I'm going to take my boy on a ride around the dance floor.
Angela grabbed Chad's hand and headed off. He gave a weak wave as they left. Trying to stand in the way of Angela DeSoto was like trying to argue with a tsunami. You could use all the words you liked, but in the end, you were still going to go under.
They seem to be a very interesting couple.
Roy pulled out a chair and sat down.
Yeah, it's a weird match, but my mother taught me that you can never really tell from looking outside in how a relationship works.
A keen insight. So, Roy, you said your name was? You mentioned your brother and I were close friends. I don't suppose you'd care to elaborate on that? Within bounds, of course.
Not much I'd care to discuss in a place like this, or at a time like now. When Herschel shows up, he can decide how much to tell you. But I will say this. Whenever you would make the group watch a cheap horror movie, he would groan with the rest of them for show. But deep down, he loved the hell out of those flicks. My brother is all kinds of nerd, and he found it interesting that a guy like you, so different from him in so many ways, shared the same love for bad gore flicks.
It sounds like your brother and I had a rare sense of appreciation to enjoy such films.
Appreciation ain't exactly what I call it. But seeing as we're in polite company, that'll have to do for now.
The slow song that Vince and Camille were hoping for never came. Though a few songs with more choreographed, less tantalizing moves did draw them out onto the dance floor again. In between, they sat around at one of the empty tables and talked. Nothing of tremendous weight was discussed, but they both felt like it was much-needed conversation. Life had grown so heady and serious this year, it was nice to talk about nothing more than bad teachers and tough classes. After the last round of choreographed dancing, they found a set of empty stools and sat down to rest.
I think that might be it for me.
Camille's heavy makeup was smudged at the edges from perspiration.
I feel like I've broken out of my bubble enough for one night.
Ditto. Plus, it would be good to see our friends some more. This is the first time I can remember in ages that the whole night has been simple and relaxed.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.